Are you working for the weekend and loving every minute of it? Mike Reno, lead singer of Loverboy, is up next.
Welcome to 15 Minutes with Chuck, where we feature interviews with music artists, entertainers, scientists, and more. Here's your host, a software consultant, teacher, and space enthusiast, Chuck Fields.
Hello, thanks so much for joining me today. I'm thrilled to introduce our special guest, Mike Reno, lead singer of Loverboy. Mike and the rest of Loverboy, along with REO Speedwagon and Styx, are performing on the road now with their tour called Live and Unzoomed. Loverboy has achieved several platinum albums and a gold with hits including Turn Me Loose, When It's Over, Lovin' Every Minute of It, and Working for the Weekend. They've also been on several movie soundtracks, including Mike's duet with Ann Wilson of Heart with Almost Paradise for Footloose and Heaven in Your Eyes for the original Top Gun. Mike joins me today on the road to discuss the tour and his amazing music.
15 Minutes with Chuck.
Mike, thanks so much for joining me. It's an honor.
Thank you, man. I appreciate you having me, really.
Oh, well, we're glad to have you. And I got to ask you about this tour, because you're out there now with REO Speedwagon and Styx. We love the name, Live and Unzoomed. It's about freaking time. The black hole COVID is behind. How's it going? What's it like to be back out there?
Well, first off, it's a pleasure to work with these guys. We've been friends for years. When they invited us to the tour, I was blown away, and I was really excited because, I mean, there's been like a full house every night. There was 19,000 people last night, and I just went, wow, this is insane, or the night before. So here's the deal. I think people have been locked up for so long. They're just dying to have some fun. And what more fun is it than Loverboy playing all their hits, and then REO or Styx, you know, either band playing all their hits. I watch the shows every night. I mean, I'm the last guy off the stage. I can't get enough of these guys. And a couple of them play golf. So we're going to start having some fun when it warms up a little bit. It's been a little bit rainy here today.
Yeah, that's awesome. So I didn't know about golf, but I also heard an interesting fact that you also are an avid bicyclist.
Bicycles. You know what happened? Funny thing is, I've got a couple of nice bikes at home, but yeah, I didn't want to bring them. You know, you have to package them up and set them. And so what I did is I actually, one of my roadie went on Craigslist and bought one for $100, and it's perfect. It runs great. Somebody bought it and never used it, kind of thing. And so I got, I was fortunate enough to get it, and I was out all day yesterday in it. So it was fun.
Isn't it great? Yeah, because I do that too. I just wondered, city to see, that seems like a great way to see it. Do you like playing your routes in advance or just kind of wing it when you get to town?
I wing it. You know, I did have to put on my tracking device to find the hotel again last night. And a seagull did poop on me. So I knew I was really close to the lake. So
I'm sorry.
We had some fun. I went cruising around the Lake District there. And then I realized that I looked up and I realized that we're playing in this big place right over here. And I went, that's where we're playing.
Because I remember
seeing Nickelback in that place last time I was in town.
I was going to ask you, Mike, this is actually about, my wife kind of had this question. I kind of think about this too. You've been touring for, you know, well, you've been out concerting for a while, you know, since the 80s, I think. How has it changed? You know, as far as like the venues, the people, the performance itself, how's it changed?
Honestly, nothing has changed, really.
Oh, it's good to hear.
It's exactly the same. The energy is the same. The backstage, there's people doing everybody's got a job. It's like watching an anthill. You know, it's like I get there and there's people setting up cables, people moving stuff around, and there's other people making food. There's people ironing clothes. I mean, it's just the same as it always was. It really is no different. You know, really, it's a very comfortable place to be because I'm used to that and I'm glad it didn't change. It feels the same to me.
That's awesome. I do want to, let's talk about your musical journey. Cause you know, like I said, it goes way back, but I heard, you know, some of your early inspirations on were the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, of course, huge inspiration. Then you started playing drums and singing background harmonies for, I think, your older brother's band when you're just 11 years old. Tell me about that. How did you get started?
Well, I was a young kid. I was kind of an entrepreneur. I started delivering the morning paper. And then after school, I would go in front of the department store and I'd buy a handful of papers for 7 cents and I'd sell them for 15 cents. But everybody would throw me a quarter and tap my head and say, cute kid, you know, but I ended up getting enough money to buy a set of drums. My brother was a guitarist. So I said, okay, I'm going to join him. he's the one who taught me, you know, how to be entrepreneurial. And so he started, I started, that he had a band, but I was too young to be in his band until his drummer ended up vanishing. And then he went somewhere and got married and he never came back for the at least for that weekend. And my dad pulled a trailer with all our equipment in it. I had a set of drums. I was so small, you could barely see me over the tom-toms. But I knew all the music because I used to watch some practice all the time. Now, you got to imagine, this is when I'm 13, right? Oh. So, and I did it, and it was great. It was fun. And then after that, I started my own bands, and I ended up singing and playing the drums. But after a while, the guys in the band says, you know, have you seen Led Zeppelin? Have you seen Deep Purple? Have you seen, like, we got to get somebody out front. And I said, don't look at me. You know, I wasn't going to get up from behind that nice barrier, that little comfort zone.
Wow.
But I'm doing it. And I guess since I started doing it, I never looked back. I'm kind of comfortable out front now.
Yeah. It's like you found your destiny. When you said singing, did you realize, hey, you had a knack for writing songs at that time? When did that start?
Well, I left school after I graduated and I went to a bigger town. I formed a band with a bunch of guys that I met, and we tried to write some songs. It was just one of those things. We were playing all kinds of great stuff, mm-hmm. mostly cover stuff. And then we'd throw in a few of our original songs. So I started writing, I guess, when I was about 18 or 19. When I was 20, I got asked to join a band in Ontario, which had done two albums already, or three albums. And I was kind of forced in, and they kind of wanted somebody to come in and help with the writing. And I kind of just went, okay, I'll do it. You know, I was kind of, you know, pushed up against the wall. So I did it. I don't know how. I even think back nowadays. And it turns out I co-wrote every song on their album and, you know, put it out. But the band wasn't quite what I wanted in a band. After, I know, 3 years, I packed up and left. And that's when I met Paul Dean. And that's when my writing really started to get better.
See, yeah. I wondered about that because I wondered how Loverboy was formed. I always love how names come about. And I heard that Paul Dean actually had a dream that sort of evolved into Loverboy. Yeah. Is that how your name was chosen? That's so cool.
I told him the night before, you know, I thought a good idea for the band might be Coverboy.
Coverboy, okay.
And the reason being is we were hanging out with our girlfriends watching a movie on a night off of work and writing and stuff. And our girlfriends were reading their Vogue magazines and stuff, and all the girl magazines. And you see the cover girls on the front. And it struck me as Coverboy. That would be kind of a cool play on words. And maybe we would, instead of wearing jeans like the Doobie Brothers, you know, we would wear some nice clothes and get some flashy color happening. And that might be our little thing, you know. And as it turns out, Paul calls me the next day and he said, I had this dream. Yeah. He says, what if we call ourselves Loverboy? And I said, Paul, we're going to get the snot kicked out of us if we do that. And as it turned out, we haven't had a problem, luckily. But try living with the name Loverboy when you're in your mid-60s. Not easy, Chuck.
Well, only you could pull it off, Mike. That's awesome. And then, so let's real quick to, because again, I know it's been a while. You still have new songs. I mean, you have Release, which is just came out this year. It's freaking awesome. But still, I mean, I grew up on your music, like, you know, all of our tons of listeners out there. I mean, some of the first songs I ever remember hearing were like, you know, Turn Me Loose, of course, Working for the Weekend, you know, right. When It's Over. Yeah, I grew up with these. And I actually heard one of your favorite songs to perform or to sing is When It's Over. Is that right?
Yeah, it is. It was a song I wrote basically after a 12-year relationship went a bust. Hmm. And it was to no fault of my own, of course. It wouldn't be my fault.
Of course.
But I actually,
you're a lover boy.
I went on tour and we were invited to do this tour with Kansas right off the bat, as soon as the first album was finished. And I, you know, we couldn't say no. So my girlfriend, for some reason, said, if you take that tour, I'm not going to be here when you get back. I thought she was kidding, right? Because I knew I'd be away for a while.
Yeah.
And as it turned out, I came home after the tour and she was gone.
So wow.
I kind of wrote the whole thing, I hope you're with me when it's over. And it was over, obviously, but I wanted to be friends because we never had a bad thing to, you know, to say to each other. It was just she wanted to do something and I had to do something different.
Wow.
Kind of sad, right?
Yeah, it is sad, but it's so amazing, you know, where inspiration comes, right? I mean, you're an artist and you know, that's a real life story. It's painful, but you drew from the pain and came up with a song that's absolutely amazing. I guess to showcase your talent too, I mean, something that I kind of love too is just the music soundtracks that you've helped with. Footloose, let's talk about Almost Paradise, your duet with Ann Wilson, 1984. What I heard is that you actually recorded that in one take. Is that true, Mr. Showoff over here?
You know what? I was in the studio in Chicago. We had a beautiful studio all set up and the music was kind of recorded. So really all we had to do were the vocals. And Anne was a bit late, but it wasn't a big deal. And she finally got there and I wanted to get comfortable with her. So we sat in chairs. It's like I'm sitting now and across from each other. And I said, "You want a drink or anything or a beer or something?" You know, being a true Canadian, I offered her a beer. Of course. So we kind of sat there for a few minutes and then talked and then I said, "Do you know the song?" And she says, yeah, I know it. And I knew it too. I didn't even have a lyric sheet. And we both stood up, she sang it facing me and I faced her in the same microphone. We did it once. And Keith Olsen, the producer, just put his arms up and went, "Unbelievable." You know, he said, "Thank you." And it turned out really nice.
Yeah, you know, it did.
Very simple song. And when I was asked to do it, they told me, I could pick any female I wanted to sing it. And I immediately asked for Ann Wilson because
she's great.
I don't know if everybody knows this, but I'm from Vancouver, Canada, on the West Coast, just a little north of Seattle. And they were from Seattle, but they were in Vancouver for like 10 years. And they actually played around all the clubs and we used to go see them. And they were the band who played all the Led Zeppelin covers. And they were awesome. I thought they played better than Led Zeppelin. And then they started recording and they recorded in Vancouver. They recorded their first album in Mushroom Studios where we recorded Get Lucky.
So that's cool. I'm just thinking now I'm going over these visions I have because I went to Vancouver. My wife and I went there several years ago. That's a beautiful area. What a place to grow up in. I couldn't imagine.
Yeah, it's nice. I kind of grew up in a city about 4 hours east of there where they grow all the fruit and the grapes and they make nice. Now the wine and stuff. And there's two big, beautiful lakes. It was called the Okanagan Valley, but we used to drive into Vancouver, a whole van full of us, like a bunch of crazy people, and go to all the concerts. And we used to see Heart all the time. It's just an interesting story, but I couldn't believe how great she sang. And I immediately picked her. She was my first choice without a doubt.
Well, you two did just an amazing job. Almost Paradise. Clearly a great song. Another soundtrack, of course, kind of popular these days too. Top Gun, the original Top Gun, Heaven in Your Eyes. How did that come about? How did you end up doing the Top Gun song?
Well, it's a pretty good story, Chuck. I just finished actually sending a quote. They wanted a quote about the movie, you know, doing the first movie. So I just sent a quote and it reminded me of the story, if you want to hear it. We got a call that Simpson and Bruckheimer wanted to meet me.
Nice.
So I flew down to Los Angeles on Monday, went directly to Paramount Studios, got all the way into this office, walked into this giant office, and there was a popcorn machine in the middle of this huge office. And two guys were walking past each other like two ships in the night, talking about things. And it took them about 5 minutes to realize I was standing right there. And they stopped and went, "Can we help you?" And I said, "I'm Mike Reno. You wanted to talk to me." And they go, "Oh, yeah. Okay, Mike, come over and look at this." So they took me over in the corner and they put a cassette in and they played a scene from the Top Gun movie. They said, "Could you write a song for this scene?" And, you know, being overly confident at the time, because you have to be. Yeah. I said, "Absolutely, I'll do it. When do you need it?" And they said, "Thursday." I said, "This Thursday?" I said, "You know, it's Monday, right? That's like 3 days from now." So I reluctantly agreed, got back on the airplane same day, and I phoned and I asked the guys to go in the studio. We had a song worked up part ways. We were working with another guy, a friend of ours who's a writer-producer, and they had a song started, but it turned out better for us. So we went in and did it, and Paul and I finished writing it, and for us, turned it into a Loverboy song. And we recorded it, mixed it, sent it down by Thursday. And they went, we love it. Thank you very much. And it ended up on the soundtrack. It's really amazing that it happened in 3 or 4 days, because stuff like that doesn't happen.
Well, I mean, when you're dealing with talented people who have the gift, and you certainly do. I mean, it's just amazing. And I got to ask this too. I know it's been out for a few weeks. Have you seen the new Top Gun Maverick?
No, but I think I might go tonight.
You should definitely see it.
I heard it's even better than the first one.
It is. I have to be honest. My wife and I saw it on opening night, and like you, we have the most amazing wives in the world, because we had our anniversary a few days after that. And she said, why don't we go see it again for our anniversary? I'm like, okay.
That is, you know what? I went over to Chicago. I worked with Tom Petterick on a song for Top Gun Maverick. And we sent it in. I imagine a lot of people did. And we had this song that was fabulous. It was called Without a Bullet Being Fired. And it was perfectly, it was written for the movie. But I don't think, I'm pretty sure they didn't choose it. But if I go tonight and it's in the movie, I'm going to go out of my mind. But I don't think they chose it. They would have told me.
Oh, that's going to be incredible. Mike, I just want to ask you, I guess, one more question too. Something that amazes me, and I don't know why I think this, but sometimes I think, you know, you're with these other groups and I'm thinking, well, why would you be, you know, are they really friends or not? And you seem to have genuine friendships with these other groups. And it makes sense to me, because obviously you and them have something in common, right? You're like writing music, performing music. Tell us about that. I mean, some of your great friends, I remember you talking about Alice Cooper and some others. How does that happen? That's just incredible.
Well, you know what it is? We're just people like anybody else. And we're all backstage together. I've known most of these guys for years. I mean, we've been playing these concerts, outdoor concerts, for years, and we played together lots of times. And I remember once years ago, Tommy Shaw came on stage with us in a nightclub in Vancouver. I think it was even before we got a record contract. And he walked up, we invited up on stage because we knew who he was, and we were kind of going, that's Tommy Shaw. You want to come up and play a song? And he got up, we jammed together. I mean, that's 40 years ago. And we're still friends. And when I saw him, I said, I want to give you a big hug, but we're trying not to get too close to each other backstage. So we basically just stood and had a nice little chat. We're trying not to anybody to get sick with COVID. So everybody's kind of a bit cautious, but
sure.
Not as cautious as I thought they were going to be. And but the backstage kind of restricted. But so a couple of the guys love golf. Ricky, bass player with Styx, he wants to golf. Bruce, bass player for REO, he wants to golf. I asked Kevin if he wanted to golf. He goes, you don't want to see me golf, Reno. It's a tough game. But I love golf. And when I'm during the winter, when I'm in California, I golf 3 times a day. If I'm off, you know, if I'm not working.
18 holes at a time each time?
3 times a week. Did I say three times?
You just 3 times a day. I'm like, that's your whole day. My shoulders and back would be killing me. 3 times a week. I think that's incredible. And I got to ask you this too. Last question here, I promise. I know you're busy with the tour, which is incredible. What's next for you in the band? Any new music or what's coming up?
You know what? We've been dying to go in the studio, but we weren't supposed to be gathering. 2 years has gone by. Paul and I have been working on some stuff. Paul and I actually got together once. The other guys didn't. And we sent some stuff out via email, which we can do nowadays, which I don't know if the people understand. We can actually do a bed track to music and have our bassist in Winnipeg play his part and then send it to North Carolina for our drummer. He'll play his part. And a couple of us in Vancouver, we just email it around. And Paul came over and we did the vocals and finished the lyrics and everything. And then Paul mixed it. We put a little video out with it. We would like to go back in the studio, to be honest with you, Chuck, and just bash out a whole bunch of rock and roll. And we're looking forward to doing it after this tour is over.
I tell you, well, we're looking forward to it. And Mike, I just want to thank you again. I want to wish you and the rest of Loverboy and, of course, REO Speedwagon and Styx the best for this tour. Again, our audience out there, go check them out. They're going to be all over the U.S. I think you're actually going to some other countries in there later on. Who knows? But Mike, thanks again for joining me. Really appreciate it.
My pleasure, Chuck. It was super fun.
15 Minutes with Chuck.
Well, it was such a thrill speaking with Mike, and I'm so excited about their music and their tour. If you'd like to learn more, just go to their website, loverboyband.com. I want to thank Mike for joining me today. I want to thank you for joining me as well. If you can do me a small favor and like this episode and share it with a friend, I'd certainly appreciate it. Thanks so much for taking time to join us today. We'll see you next time. God bless.